Welcome to Canvas Church. You are listening to our weekly celebration service message. Thank you for tuning in.
Amen. Come on. Get your Bibles out. Go to 1 Samuel chapter 30. You don't have a Bible, it'll be up on the screens here for you. Great way to get a Bible is just by getting out your phone and downloading that digital Bible. Then you have it with you wherever you go. 1 Samuel chapter 30, let me set it up for you. 1 Samuel chapter 30, here's what's taking place. David has been anointed to be the next king of Israel. The first king of Israel, Saul, has started out well, but has disobeyed God, and because of his disobedience is no longer under the leadership of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's no longer leading the way God intended him to lead. And he's no longer covered. And so Samuel, the prophet, under the inspiration of God, comes and anoints a young boy named David to be the next king of Israel. And there's a big gap between the time he's anointed to be king and the time he actually becomes king. There's years. There's some 13, 14 plus years from the time of his anointing to the time he steps into the thing that God has for his life, which in and of itself is a lesson for us today, that there's a big distinction between the anointing that God has for you. That would be the dream, the thing that God's revealed to you. This is what I want to do in your life. This is what I want you to fulfill with your life. There's a big gap between that and actually walking in it. And everything in there, from the time of the realization of what God wants to do and the fulfillment of what God's to do, is called character building. Because, man, if the character ain't there, man, you're not going to be able to sustain in the appointment. There's a big difference between the anointing and the appointing. And David finds out firsthand what that looks like. And so David is anointed to be king, but he's not king. And so he finds himself actually running for his life because now Saul is trying to kill him and trying to take him out. Through his journey, he finds himself living in caves. He finds himself living in foreign lands. He finds himself just hiding out because he's trying to spare his own life. In that time, he has now gathered around himself about 600 friends that becomes known as David's army. Do a little research on that. David's army isn't really a mighty army. It's a bunch of thieves. It's a bunch of murderers. It's a bunch of rejected people that are also trying to escape and run for their lives, and they actually gather themselves around David, and David becomes their leader. In the process of this, then, David actually leaves his homeland, and he makes a pact with Israel's greatest enemy, the Philistines. And the Philistines, therefore, allow David to live in their land and in their territory and actually give him this territory, this area called Ziklag. And so we're going to read this story. 1 Samuel chapter 30, starting in verse 1. David finds himself living there. He's actually going out to battle now alongside the Philistines to actually fight against Israel, the place that he's anointed to be the king of. And as he's gone, another country comes in and raids their area. So now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day, so they've been out battling, and they're coming back to their home, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came to the city, and there it was, burned with fire, and their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with them lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. I don't know if you've ever been there before. I don't know if you ever found yourself in such a place of despair, in such a place of hopelessness, in such a place of loss, where you are so grieved that you are weeping and until you have no more strength. Has anybody ever been there? I know I have. Has anybody ever been there before? that you've lost something, you lost someone, that something was broken, some tragic event, something happened. I don't know what it was, but man, and maybe it wasn't even public and no one else knew what was going on, but you've been to that place where you wept so much that you have no more power to weep. There's nothing left inside of you. David is at the lowest place he's ever been in his life. He's anointed to be king. He's trying to do the right thing. He's trying to live the right life. He's trying to pursue the thing that God has for him. But in the process of that, he finds himself in the greatest moment of despair. And the Bible says that David and his two wives have been taken captive. Now David, verse 6, David was greatly distressed. I mean, the Bible paints the picture so clear. He's so distressed. And here's, to add injury to insult, check this out. For the people spoke of stoning him because the soul of the people was grieved, every man for his son and his daughters. And so now not only has David lost everything he owns, not only is his home burned to the ground, there's nothing left, his family isn't there, but now the people that just hours before were walking alongside of him, cheering him on as the next king, now want to kill him. Are you reading the same Bible I'm reading? This is a bad day. I mean, literally, these same people just hours before as they're out in battle, like, that's David, he's our man, he's going to be our king. Now they're like, let's kill the dude. Do I have any leaders in this place that know what I'm talking about? I don't know if you lead something, a business, or you lead a ministry. I happen to lead a church, and I'm also a coach. And we had a great season this year, and they're all celebrating me like I'm the best thing ever. And I looked at every single one of them. I said, remember this when we're 2-27. Could you remember how much you love me right now? Because one of these days, we ain't going to have that season. Are you with me? David, man, he's in a bad place. And they want to kill him. But listen to the last part of verse 6. But David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. He couldn't strengthen himself in community. Community wanted to kill him. He had no friends. He had nothing left. He couldn't find his strength in anything. He had to go someplace. And the Bible says that he found strength in the Lord his God. Verse 7, then David said to Abiathar, the priest, Ahimelech's son, please bring the ephod here to me. Now, you need to understand something, because this will come back into context in just a moment. The ephod is a particular piece that was only worn by the high priest. When he says, bring me the ephod. Now, the word ephod will be used of other things in Scripture, but here specifically, it's referencing that which the high priest wore. Now, if you don't know a lot about the high priest was the go-between between the people of Israel and God. In other words, they didn't hear God speak for themselves. The high priest had to go get in front of God, talk to God, hear the voice of God, and then distribute it to the people. Okay? And every time he would go, he'd be wearing this ephod. Now, this is a very specific, particular piece that if you go back in Scripture, you hear that God actually gave the people specific instructions of how to make the ephod, what it was to look like, how it was to be. It was very specific, and it was to go on the high priest. Specifically, it was to go on the high priest when they were to go into the moment where they were to communicate with God. Are you with me? So, in other words, it was only worn by high priest. And specifically, it was worn by the high priest when he was in communication with God, getting a word for the people. David breaks rank and he says, bring me the ephod. In other words, David does something very specific here, because something you got to understand it. David is a type and a foreshadow of Christ to come in the New Testament. And when Christ comes in the New Testament, Christ does something very specific. He sets up the new covenant. And under the new covenant, you no longer have to go through a person to hear the voice of God. You don't need a pope. You don't need a priest. You don't need a pastor. But because of Jesus Christ, you can be alone and just talk to God all on your own. It's because Jesus became the final sacrifice for all sin. The Bible says the veil was torn in two. That was a natural thing that happened, but it was prophetic and symbolic of the veil between us and God being ripped in two by the power of Christ so that you and I can now go and have direct access to God. And that's something you got to be super thankful of. Because as you study out the history, if that didn't happen, you would have been walking in with your little poodle this morning. Come on, somebody. You would have been walking in with your sacrifice, and you would have been coming up, Pastor, here you go. Can you get a word for God for me? Church looked very different back then than it does today. And you and I are very thankful. We don't have to do that anymore. Why? Because Christ became the living sacrifice. And there's one way to heaven. There's one way to the Father, and that's through Jesus. David does something very specific, and it's the second time he's done it. And he asks for the ephod. What is he saying? This is what he's saying. You got to catch this. He's saying, I need to get a word myself. This next move can't be based on somebody else's word. This next move, I can't go through somebody else. I've got to hear for God for my life right now. Bring me the ephod. He speaks to the high priest. He didn't say, hey, high priest, can you go get alone with God, get a word for me and tell me what he's saying? He said, no. I'm in a place right now where I realize I need to get alone with God myself and I need to hear a word for him. I don't need to go through Pastor Ben. I don't need to go through my small group leader. Come on. And you don't. You have direct access. Bring me the ephod. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David. Listen to what David does. David does exactly what the high priest would do when he's wearing the ephod. David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue? You need to highlight this in your head, highlight in your Bible, whatever you need to do. You need to get this. Shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And you got to know someone. You inquire of God and you ask him a question, he's a good God. He answers. He said, Pastor, what does the answer look like? Does it come audible? Sometimes. Sometimes it's just that still, small, quiet voice inside that we call, that the world likes to call intuition. The Holy Spirit speaks to you. Sometimes it will come through a scripture. Sometimes it'll come through a phenomenal message on a Sunday morning. Shall I pursue? Shall I go after him? And God answered, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them. Listen to it now. And without fail, recover all. He has nothing. He's lost everything. And he goes and inquires of the Lord, hey, what do you want me to do? I want you to go because you're going to recover all. So David went. He and the 600 men who were with him, the guys that were going to kill him just moments earlier, and came to the brook of Besor, where those stayed who were left behind. But David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 stayed behind, who were so weary they could not cross the brook Besor. Listen, this was a journey, and they were in pursuit, and they were exhausted. But even in exhaustion, David continued to pursue. Drop down to verse 18. Verse 18. So David recovered all. I love that verse. So David recovered all. So David, someone needs to hear that today. So put your name there. So Ben recovered all. Covered all. All that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking. That would be a good place to say amen. Now listen to this next part. This next part gets me, because this is the Bible, and the Bible doesn't spare any detail. And it says this, either small or great. He recovered everything. And the Bible goes on to say, I just want you to catch the picture. He recovered everything, all of it. Well, what about, no, catch it. The small things and the big things, he got back. See, some of you are settling right now in your walk. Some of you are settling right now in the thing that God has. So you are settling for too little. You're like, well, I guess, you know, this happened, so maybe not all of that can come to pass. You know, this unexpected hiccup in the journey. This thing happened to me, this hurt, this pain, this breakup, this divorce, this loss, this thing. So maybe, you know, life isn't going to look the way I thought it was going to look. No, you're going to recover all. The small things and I don't know who needs to hear this. Someone needs to hear it. You're settling. They're like, well, I guess, you know, maybe there's another part. Maybe there's a plan B, and so I'll go to plan B. It's not quite as great as plan A, but, you know, that's just the way it goes. He recovered everything, the small things and the big things. Sons and daughters, spoiled. Everything which they had taken from them. Listen to it. It says it again. David recovered all. Then David took all the flocks and herds. They had driven before those other livestock, and they said, this is David's spoil, recover all. I want to talk to you for the next few moments about the idea of recover all. God, we thank you so much for your word. God, we thank you that your word is awesome. Lord, I pray today, God, that your word would get somebody right where they're at. God, the person that's settling. God, in the hurt, the person that's settling in the loss, the person that's settling in the despair, God, you would get a hold of their heart, and God, you would show them that there is opportunity to recover all. God, I pray you'd help me in this place, create an environment for people to discover your son, Jesus, to know your incredible love and realize the awesome plan that you have for them. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Many of you don't know this story. It's always what I share with you real quickly. But my wife and I, when we first started the church, we actually just celebrated 11 years as Canvas Church. And I'm telling you, the last 6-7 months, man, the church has been growing like exponentially. I mean, the church, I don't know if I shared this last week, but Easter week, we had 844 people participating in our church. That's awesome. And I'm telling you, just over the last 6-7 months, man, things are happening. People are coming, getting plugged in, becoming a part of small groups, becoming a part of ministry teams, and crazy things are happening. But prior to that, my wife and I, before we became Canvas Church, we were Urban Church. And my wife and I and a core group of people had moved here and started Urban Church. It wasn't in Escondido. It was in San Diego. And we were portable at the time. And you might not know what that means. Portable means this. We didn't have a building. And so we met in schools or theaters. Sometimes when the janitor didn't show up to unlock the school, we met out in the courtyard of the school. Happened several times. God bless them. And we would bring everything that you see here, not quite everything you would see here, but we'd bring instruments on, we'd set it up, we would worship, we'd have church, and then we'd tear it all down. We'd set up the kids' classrooms, and we'd set it up, and we'd have service, and we'd tear it all down, and then we'd do it all over again the following. So we were portable. And in being portable, man, we had trailers, and everything was stored in trailers, and we would drive it back and forth, and we had a setup team and a pack-up team. And does anybody miss those days? Thank you for not raising your hand, because I don't miss those days either. So glad we got a building. Thank you, Jesus. I think we should figure out something for all the people that didn't get to experience those days, though. Like, just stack chairs at the end of every service and then unstack them, you know? Like, But we were early on in this whole church planning thing, and the particular location we were meeting at was this school, and we got targeted as a church. They knew we met at this school, and we got hit with an arson when we were Urban Church, and all of the accelerant, everything was dumped all over our stuff that was stored there and whatnot, and that stuff that didn't fit in the trailers, and we got hit with an arson, and I'll never forget that day. And so we got hit with this arson. We lost. It was a total loss. We lost everything, even stuff we thought was salvageable. They're like, no, it's got smoke damage. And we're like, you don't know what smoke damage is until you've actually experienced fire. I mean, it's bad. And so it's total loss. And so after months of working with the insurance company that eventually dropped us, insurance is great. After months of working with insurance, and we accumulated all this stuff back, in the meantime, there was a church that was just loaning us stuff and lending us. We were just limping by trying to do this thing called church. And we got everything back. We're excited. Okay, we're going to go for it. And it couldn't have been more than 30 days. And we had brand new equipment. And we're obviously in a new location now because that one got burnt. And so we have this nice storage unit, secured, gated, cameras. Our trailers are parked there. And my wife comes in one day. We were doing offices out of our house because we didn't have an office. And so we'd have the staff come over to our home. We'd make it into an office. And we were just, you know, doing all this stuff. She came over. She had this look on her face. I said, what's wrong? She goes, we need to get to the storage unit. And I'm like, why? She goes, because the sheriff's department just called me. And the place got hit. And it looks like everything in our trailers is totally stolen. 30 days after, we just got it back. And I looked at my wife, and I looked at her, and I said, and we'd probably been going for what, 3 years? Two and a half, something. I looked at her, and I said, if it's all gone, I'm done. I'm not gonna be a pastor anymore. And I don't know what she did at that moment. She kind of told me later. She texted everybody she knew, like, you need to pray for the pastor. He wants to quit. Anybody ever felt like quitting before? Yeah. Listen, I had poured everything into planning this church. And when I mean everything, I mean everything. I mean hundreds of thousands of our own dollars. I mean time. I mean relationships. I mean loss of relationships. We were fully invested. And we had just walked through this arson. And we had just got everything back to try to keep going. And it's all gone. And I said, I'm done. Literally, as we're driving, before we started driving there, I prayed this prayer. This is a true story. I said, God, I pray that everything is truly gone so that I can be done. I was in the lowest place of my life, ministry-wise, not just because of the loss of that stuff, but because leadership is difficult. And I was at the lowest place, and I was like, I'm done. I don't want to do this anymore. I just, you know, give me one of those hot dog carts. I'll go and stand outside ball games. Oh, you laugh, but it's real. You can't disappoint somebody with a hot dog. Ketchup, mustard, mayo, onions, grilled. What do you want? Those are the items you have to choose for. Okay, you know I'm a hot dog stand. I'm not a hamburger stand. What do you want? There it is. Can I have your $30, please? You know, like, probably would have made more, too. Anyway. Oh, man. I was in the low place. I was hurting. I wanted to be done. But from the drive from my house, about a 20-minute drive, to that storage unit, I began to do something. I began to strengthen myself in the Lord. In that drive from my house to the storage unit, just had a lucid interval of some common sense come to me, and I began to turn to God, and I began to strengthen myself in the Lord. And I began to change my prayer, and I said, God, if you don't want this to be over, we better find some stuff when we get there. And we got there. And I'm telling you now, I'm excited. My soul got corrected. And we got there. And we go to our trailer. And I'm telling you, probably 90% of the stuff is no longer in our trailers. And I'm like, okay, that's there. And they show, well, here's the direction they left. And we started walking throughout that whole entire storage unit. And literally 20 feet over here was a subwoofer. 30 feet over here was a speaker. 10 feet over here was a bass guitar. 15 feet over here was the children's stuff. And literally, as we walked throughout this whole entire thing, we literally found strewn throughout the whole entire place, we recovered everything that they thought was stolen. Why do I share that with you? David is in a place of great despair. He's in a great place of great loss. And somewhere in here, now listen, we get to read it, and it takes us about 4 minutes to read it. But this was real time for David, and you got to understand something. There is a great distance between loss and recovery. There is a big difference between those moments of despair and dysfunction and hopelessness where I feel like, you know what, I hope it is over. I don't want to go on. I don't want to move on. I would rather be dead. They all want me dead. There's a big gap between there and recovering all. And the big gap is either destruction or it's production. It's either I live in this moment of despair and dysfunction and pain and loss, or I respond to the situation and allow it to produce something in me that gives me strength so that I can get to the place where I recover all. Why is it that people can walk through the same thing, the same circumstance, and yet they stay in that pain, they stay in that loss, and they stay in that dysfunction, but there's others that respond to it, and all of a sudden there's joy in their life, there's happiness in their life, there's fulfillment in their life, and all of a sudden, man, they begin to recover things in their lives. Anybody know what I'm talking about today? What's the difference? The difference is by the way you respond to it. And I'm telling you right now, the Bible shows us time and time again how to have a healthy response in those moments. And David shows us how to have a healthy response. Listen, I know that the context of David's situation, the context of my story might look different than yours, but the feelings are the same. Right? That feeling of hopelessness, that feeling of shame, that feeling of like, I don't even want to be around people right now because if they know what's going on in my life, they might. Y'all know what I'm talking about? And the problem, I think, becomes when we don't recognize and call things for what it really is. See, too many people go through life and they encounter something like this. You can label it whatever you want. You can label it a breakup, right? You can label it a dream that's broken. You can label it divorce. You can label it I was hurt at a church. You can label it whatever you want. But the reality is we know what it's like to feel this way. But here becomes the problem. Too oftentimes we say, well, that's just life. It's just the way it is. It's just life. And so what happens is we begin to say, well, okay, this happened. That's the way things are. And so we determine that's the way things are. And because that's the way things are, then that's what I become to expect. Man, I told you this series is going to be like doing big group therapy. Next week we'll have couches in here for everybody. You've got to learn to recognize that this is not good. This is not God. This is not God's intention. This is not God's best. This is bad. This is wrong. This is not the way it's supposed to be. And if you can get to that place and label it, now all of a sudden you begin to realize, okay, that's not what God has for me. That's not good. And then I can keep moving forward and keep looking for the good things that God has for me. But if I label that as that's just the way life is, then that's what I begin to expect, and then I settle for less than God's best in my life. David, he realizes it's a bad situation. He realizes this is not a good place. He's broken. But just like David, I believe, no matter what your despair, what your dysfunction, what the pain is, what the loss is, I believe with all my heart, just like David, you're going to recover all. The small and the great. The big, the little, that you're going to recover it all. And we learn, I believe, from David's response, maybe some cues, and there's no points. Let's just look at David and what he did. And learn from it, and grow from it, and maybe make some changes in our life. First thing David does, when he's in this moment of despair, the Bible says, and David strengthened himself in the Lord. Didn't strengthen himself in community. Didn't strengthen himself in church. Man, church can be a strength to you, but not when everybody in your church wants to kill you. He had to learn. He had to go someplace. And he had to strengthen himself in the Lord. And listen to me, you and I need to strengthen ourselves in the Lord, because if we don't, we get stupid. Look at the two different responses here. David strengthens himself in the Lord. The 600 people he's with, after they weep bitterly, they're like, hey, what are we going to do? How are we going to resolve this? They're like, kill him. That's their response. How dysfunctional is that? Like, you know, like, guys, let's powwow for a minute. Where's David? I don't know. He's doing something. What was he doing? Strengthen himself in the Lord. And I don't know if they just powwowed and they're like, hey, what should we do? What's going to make us feel really good about this moment? Killing David. But yeah, just wait a second. Well, when we were on our way back to Ziklag, we were singing his praises. Like, he's the next anointed king. He's the guy we want on the throne. He's the guy we want leading us. Yeah, but I'd feel really good if we killed him. which is a totally different subject, but what, you know, you need to learn from this is that when you're in moments of despair, don't make big decisions. Do not make big decisions in a moment of despair. Why? Because they'll be stupid. What do we need to do? We need to do what David did. What did he do? Strengthen himself in the Lord. And see, I believe at large, and obviously if people don't know about Jesus and they're not in relationship with Jesus, it might be difficult, but let's just take it to a church setting then. I believe that there are too many people not finding their strength in the Lord. They're not finding their strength in the Lord. They're finding momentary relief in other things. They're not finding their strength in the Lord. Listen, there's very few things in this world that the world has to offer that will actually give you strength. They'll medicate it. They'll give you temporary relief for the pain you're walking through. Oh, it could be anything. I'm going to go shopping. Really? Me too. It could be anything. What is it? What's your vice? What's people's vice? What do they turn to? Listen, you can find a lot of things that will medicate, that will mask the pain, that will give you temporary relief. But listen to me, I'll be honest with you. Most things in life outside of Christ are designed to give you temporary relief because they want you to be hooked on it because they're making money off of it. You name it. I'm not just talking about medication. Like you get from a doctor, I'm talking. You sucked in now. Felt good for a moment. All of a sudden that wears off. And then I need more. And here's the thing. It's not just I need more of that dose. I need a higher dose. Is this too real for you guys? Doesn't give you strength. Gives you momentary relief. There's only one place you can get true strength, and that's in the Lord. David knows that, and he goes, and the Bible says he strengthens himself. He strengthens himself in the Lord. I think we need to learn to do the same thing in our response, because if not, we could listen. You can find momentary relief by coming to church, and church is good. But just because something's good, here's people's thinking. Well, I've exchanged the bad thing I was addicted to. I found an all-natural. Oh, man. Listen, hear my heart, and you need to know this. I'm not opposed to medications. There's a place and a purpose for them. But that place and that purpose is momentary. To get you to a place where you're thinking properly and acting properly and can make decisions, that's great. But you've got to get to a place as a Christ follower, you're strengthening yourself in the Lord. In Him. David finds strength in the Lord. Because listen to me now, he recognized, you got to catch this, before he could experience restoration, he had to be restored. There had to be an inward restoration before there could be an outward restoration. Because if not, if David didn't get to the Lord and find strength in the Lord and he wasn't restored inwardly, then all of a sudden, here's what happens. It's no better than anything else. His restoration inwardly is now contingent on what he gets outwardly. If the only time he is going to feel whole and he is going to feel strengthened and he is going to feel restored is if I get it back, then I'll feel restored. If I get all this stuff, that's like on the way from the house to the storage unit, God did a work in me that I could be satisfied in him, strengthened in him, not based on what I got back. Because in all our life, we'll just be chasing something. when our strength comes. Is anybody getting anything out of this? When our strength comes through him and him alone, which then begs the question, how do I find strength in the Lord? And this is where everybody in here that's taking notes is like, give me some points on how I can be strengthened in the Lord. And I want you to know something. There ain't no points. That's what we want. We want a list. Okay, sweet. I got to strengthen myself, Lord. Tell me how to do that. Because you're there, I could give you some points, but the way I find strength in the Lord might not be the way you find strength in the Lord. We used to have a piano at our house. I kind of miss the piano. And I'm not a prolific piano player, but I like to dabble a little bit. If we had the new piano, the red one, I'd probably get up there and do it, but we got this old one. I don't want. And that's one of the ways I'd find strength. I'd just go and I'd sit, and you can ask my kids and my wife. I'd just go there and sit. And I probably played the same thing every time, but I just found strength in the Lord. But how do you find strength in the Lord? But let me tell you this. The Bible actually shows us how we get strengthened in the Lord. Let me read it to you. This will help you. How do you find strength in the Lord? The Bible says this in Psalm 27:14. It's going to blow your mind. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. I don't like that one, Pastor. Are you sure that's biblical? That's only one verse. Let me give you another one. Isaiah 40:31. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. How do I find strength in the Lord? I wait. This message just got worse, didn't it? Because you know what we suck at? Waiting. That's why we're addicted to stuff. That's why we go to the momentary relief. Because it's instant. It's available. It's right there. It doesn't involve me. Listen, you're looking at probably the most impatient person in the room. I lack patience greatly. I can admit it. There was a time when you were all wrong and I was right. No, I'm not impatient. You guys just don't know what you're talking about. You guys are all just slow. What's wrong with you? I'm impatient. But I've had to learn to wait. And we hate waiting. And our society is not built for waiters. It's instant gratification everywhere you go. I mean, how lazy have we become? I mean, if you have to wait more than 3 minutes at Chick-fil-A in the drive-thru, you're like, this place is falling apart. Are you kidding me right now? Like, within 5 minutes of not getting out of your car, you have a fully equipped meal for you. And you're like, oh, that took 2 minutes longer than last time. And you, I mean, you don't even have to leave your house now. And then you're sitting there watching the driver on Uber Eats, like, oh, they're making a left turn. They're almost here. I'm famished. We hate waiting. Because waiting involves nothing. And that can't work. That can't be right. But that's how we find strength in the Lord. There's no timeline to it. It's just like, you know, like, okay, I'm going to go wait. God, I don't feel so good still. Wait. At what point in the waiting? God called in the first service, too. That is amazing. I think almost at the exact same point, too. I think it was on the same, I was in the same point of the message. Phone rings. It's like, oh, wow, I guess, well, here he is. Must be a good message. You know, he's watching from heaven on YouTube, you know. David waited. See, you're looking for the quick fix. And that's why you're not finding strength. It's why you're limping through life. It's why you have to constantly manage your meds and constantly get with those friends and constantly hit the bottle and constantly look at the picture and constantly, because you're limping through life. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. David don't stop there, though. David says, bring me the ephod. What does David do? David inquires of the Lord. See, it's one thing for you to get strengthened in the Lord. It's a completely other thing for now that you're strengthened to say, you know what? Maybe there's a road map out of this pit. He could have been strengthened and still in his despair. He could have been strengthened and still sending Ziklag with everything around him burned down, which is exactly what some of us do. I feel good. I went to church. Feeling strengthened today. And then Wednesday, you're like, whoa, can't wait for Sunday. Well, good, you get strengthened, but you're still living in despair. You're still living in this place. You're still living in this dysfunction. You're still, man, but I just got to get through. I feel strengthened again. Okay, all right, I can manage the despair. God doesn't want you to manage the despair. God wants you to get out of the despair. And the only way you get out of the despair is once you're strengthened. You better get a word from God. You better hear from God. And David inquires of the Lord. He breaks protocol. He's like, man, I ain't going through Pastor Ben. I ain't going through Pastor Katie. I ain't going through the worship team. I got to hear from God by myself. And he inquires. And God speaks. And God tells him. Look, he inquires of the Lord. So good. God speaks. And this is what God says. Pursue. For you shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all. See, you got access. You can talk to Jesus. It's just a conversation. You can do it when you're driving your car. You can do it at home. You can do it like I did when I was back in the days when I was in high school and I was super slow running the mile. And everyone was faster than me, so I was running by myself. What was I doing? I was talking to Jesus. True story. I just talked to him. You can talk to him anywhere you want. Have a conversation. Inquire of the Lord. He speaks, and he gives them the game plan. And what's the game plan? Here's the game plan. See, most of us, though, when we inquire of the Lord, here's what we want God to say. It's going to be okay. I'm going to bring everything back to you. That's what we want. We want pixie dust. We want fairy tales. We want Cinderella stories, right, with fairy godmothers. That's what we want. If I'm honest, that's what we want, right? When we go and inquire of the Lord, we rarely pray the prayer David did, this is David's essential prayer. God, what do you want me to do? Listen to the prayer. God, what do you want me to do? Most of our prayers are like this. God, this is what I want you to do. Could you fix this? Could you fix me? Could you fix them? Right? Did I just describe 90% of our prayers? Maybe 99.9? God, could you get me out of this situation? God, could you do? That's not what David said. Hey, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And God wants you to do something. God wants you to participate in his plan. God wants you to participate in his purpose. But we just want to sit around because it's easier and be like, well, I learned how to wait, found strength. This is awesome. God, what are you going to do for me now? And I love God's response because I think somebody needs to hear this. The reason you are still wallowing in despair and dysfunction and destruction and pain and hurt and going back to that moment when that person broke your heart or did that thing and you needed to start now finding momentary relief of that, you're still there. Because you don't want to hear what God has to say. Because when he speaks, it's not always like, I got you. Now listen to me, sometimes it is. He's a miracle worker. Nothing's impossible with God. But sometimes I think I've learned most of the time we got to participate with the miracle. We got to participate with what God's doing. He inquires and God speaks. Yeah, go, buddy. Go get it. It's yours. You're going to recover all. Pursue. Listen to the word he uses. Pursue. Do a little Bible word search on that. Pursue. That isn't like, okay, I'm going to, you know, a couple days from now, we'll get after it. No, this is, go, get up, get moving, man. Go overtake him. You're going to get everything back. Get a word from the Lord. Stop living by emotions. Check this out. David obeyed the Lord. You got to hear that one, and here's why you got to hear that one. David is pursuing the Amalekites. And if you read the whole story, in him pursuing them, God is like, I want you to take them out. Annihilate them. Don't leave them. Take them all out. Pursue. Get rid of them, and you're going to recover all. The reason why Saul, the first king, is no longer king or the anointed one of God is because if you go back a couple of chapters, what you're going to read is that God spoke to Saul, I want you to take out the Amalekites, and I don't want you to leave them on the planet. And so the Bible says, and Saul disobeyed the Lord. And the Spirit of the Lord lifted off of Saul and says, I'm going to get me a new king. And so the same battle that was Saul's is now David's, which tells me that sometimes the battle you're fighting isn't because of you, it's because of somebody else. Sometimes the battle you're in and the thing you're walking through is because uncle, because mom, because dad, because sometimes the battle for your marriage is because you've come from a series of divorces. It's not fair. Why do I have to do this? Sound like anybody? Look in the mirror. You ever said that before? This isn't fair. Why am I walking through this? Why am I dealing with this? Why? It doesn't matter why. Here's the important part. God spoke. You have to obey. You have to obey. God says, hey, this moment when he says, I want you to take out the Amalekites, wasn't even about getting his family back, wasn't about getting his stuff back, it was about restoring the kingdom. I'm going to test you, David. Saul failed here. You want to be king? You want to sit on the throne? Go. 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 See, it's one thing to find strength. It's another thing to inquire. It's a completely different thing to actually obey and use the tools that have been given to you to get out of the dysfunction and get to the recovery. I think, as I'll be honest with you, as a pastor, I experienced this as a coach too, but I'm sure some counselors in here could speak to it as well, some professional counselors. There's nothing worse than people spending their time and their money to sit in front of you, because listen, a counselor doesn't fix your problems. Pastoral care doesn't fix your problems. A coach in your life doesn't fix your problems. Here's what all of them have in common. We give you the tools to apply to your life so that the problem can be fixed. And there's nothing worse than sitting with people week after week, giving them tool after tool, only to watch them not utilize the tools that are given to them to get out of the problem. But you know what they don't have a problem doing? Going back to the momentary relief. I'm telling you, man, you give somebody tools. And it's like, what? Just do that. And just pursue. Go after. But I'm tired. I'm exhausted. I don't even know if I can get through this. Just pursue. Go after. I know there's a discrepancy between the loss and the recovery, but if you just do what I'm telling you to do, you're eventually going to recover all. If you just pursue and don't give up. Don't grow weary in doing well. For in due season, you will reap a harvest if you don't give up. That's New Testament. Just pursue. Go after it. Why are you over here still in the loss and in the pain and the despair? I know it was difficult. I know it was real. I know it was uncomfortable. But why are you continuing to take momentary relief when if you just inquire of the Lord, He gives you the game plan? It's called the Bible. You apply it to your life. And as you apply it to your life, little by little by little, you'll eventually get to the place of recovery. Listen, God, it is not rocket science, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you're getting something out of this. It's 12:08. I've gone 8 minutes too long, but I told everybody we're just going to wait in it. I did. The first service, I was like, hey, we got to close up. There's the next service, but this one we're going to wait. Some of you are struggling right now. You're like, we got meet and greet. Sorry, babe. We got lunch plans. Are those things more important than you getting out of Ziklag? And getting to recover all. Somebody needs to hear this day. Somebody's. Because you're settling. You're settling. And you're stuck. And so many people are stuck because they're not willing to pursue. They're not willing to go after it. No, it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be easy. I said this before, what's easy in life that's worth obtaining? It's not going to be easy. It's going to be work. It's going to be difficult at times. And here's the thing I don't understand is like people have no problems continuing to go back to the quick fix and the momentary medication and the momentary relief, but they go to God one time and like, well, it's not working. It's like when I'm coaching basketball and you show a player what to do and they do it one time, like, well, I didn't work. It's like, well, number one, you suck. But just kidding. I'm just kidding.
You're kidding.
That was our novice team. You know, like, I mean, it's like, because you're not doing it right. Right? Try it again. And again. And again. And again. And again. I was like, I got this now. Again. Do that again. And again, all of a sudden, it's like, wow, this is actually fun. This actually is strengthening me. This is actually working. This is actually, I went to church one time 5 years ago, and it didn't work. Well, you weren't at Canvas, probably. I can't stress this enough. What you get on Sunday mornings, hear me. What you get on Sunday mornings, honestly, I'll say it. What you get on Sunday mornings, if that's all you get, is momentary relief. But if you grab hold of the heart of the message and you apply the Word of God to your life and you actually live it, every area of your life, relationships, do what the Bible says and apply it. What's that, walk in forgiveness? I tried that, it didn't work, and it's not going to do it. Walk in humility, not one of my character traits. You know, it's like, well, humility is not a character trait. It's a choice, but whatever, you know. Right? Like, I mean, you just apply the Bible to your life and you take the tools that are there and you do it. Life is beautiful. Listen, I didn't say life was pain-free. But in the pain, there's beauty. When you learn to respond the right way. It's time for you to get out of Ziklag. It's burned. It's destroyed. It's gone. There ain't nothing there for you anymore. It's time for you to recover all. But in order for you to recover all, you got to pursue. God, we thank you for your word today. God, we thank you that your word is awesome. God, your word is amazing. Lord, I pray that, Lord, we would take the power of the truth of your word and we would apply it to every single area of our life. Even in the moments when it doesn't make sense. Because God, if I was going to recover it all anyway, why did you let it happen? Doesn't make sense. But God, I pray we would learn the power of obedience. Just with every eye closed, every head bowed, we're going to wrap it up here. I just want you to think about this last thought. We don't obey because of the hope of a reward. I think too many times when we think about obedience, well, I'll obey because I'll get this at the end. So I'll obey because I'll get that at the end. Did you know that the majority of obedience goes back to fear and respect? Listen, when my kids were younger and I'd walk into their messy room and I'd ask them to clean it up, they didn't clean it up for the reward of a clean room. They cleaned it up because they respected me as their dad. And maybe there was a little fear factor, but they would do it. But I know as their dad that if they have a clean room, they're going to function differently. Their thoughts are going to be more clear. There's going to be less arguments over the toys and where they're at. If everything is sitting in its proper place, in its proper order. See, we don't obey God because, wow, there's going to be this great reward. See, some of us are missing it. You're not walking in obedience because you lack the respect and fear of God. Obedience is simply submission to an authority. And once you recognize that God is the authority over your life, it doesn't matter what he says, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. So Lord, I pray, God, for this beautiful community called Canvas Church, that as we continue to pursue, here's the greatest thing. The greatest thing in all of this is it's a picture of, hey, we're not pursuing stuff. We're not pursuing things. The pursuit of the Amalekites in its actual picture was about restoration of the kingdom. We're not pursuing things. We're pursuing Jesus. And as we pursue Jesus, the Bible says he makes all things new. He's the glory and the lifter up of my head. In those moments of pain and despair, guess what? He's my joy. In the presence of my enemies, he prepares a table before me. Although I might walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not going to fear any evil. Why? Because I'm pursuing Jesus, and he's got my hand, and he's leading me through. So this moment that I'm in right now that feels unbearable, that feels like David in Ziklag, where I'm weeping, and I don't know what's going to happen. I don't have to worry, because I'm pursuing Jesus. He's going to lead me through. He's going to get me to the other side. He's going to get me. And whether or not I see restoration on the outside doesn't matter, because my soul is restored as I wait upon him. And so that I pray for every person. You're here, heads bowed, eyes closed. I want to know who I'm talking to. This is the sofa moment. This is the moment where you've been hearing the word of God, and now you got something you got to apply. But you're here, and you would say, Pastor, I need to be in pursuit. There's some areas in my life that need to be restored, and I've been waiting on this fairy tale moment where it's just going to happen. But I realize that I've got to go after Jesus. I got to go after the King of Kings. I got to pursue him. I got to pursue the thing that he has for me. This message speaking to me today. Eyes closed. If that's you, just shoot your hand in the air. I'm going to pray for you right where you're at. Anybody at all? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, for honest people. God, I pray, Lord, that, Lord God, you would get them where they're at today. Pray that you truly would be the glory and the lifter up of their head. Can I have the prayer team come on up here? Prayer people, come on up. Go ahead and get up here. We're going to pray, and I'm going to dismiss. And if you're here for the meet and greet, you've been coming to church for maybe just the last few weeks. Maybe you started attending at Easter. Maybe you've been coming for months. We're going to have some of our pastors back there. We're going to have some light snacks and things. Just you walk through these double doors over into our gym. Man, there's nothing better than hanging out in the gym. Come on, somebody. Just head over there. We'll have some people that will meet you, shake your hand, just like 15 minutes. Just want to share with you the vision of the church a little bit, a couple of things, meet some leaders. But if you're here and you need to make the walk up here and get some prayer, because, man, you're exhausted, and you realize you got to be in pursuit. God's got something for you. As other people are leaving, you're going to make your way up here. God, we thank you for today. God, I pray, Lord, that you would just continue to build this beautiful community. And that, God, you'd be glorified in all that we do. Lord, I pray for those that are struggling today. I pray that you would lift them up and they would find their strength in you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. God bless you. May you're free to go. If you need prayer, though, come on. We got some wonderful people up here that would love to pray with you before you leave. They can encourage you. They can give you a Bible if you need one. They can point you in the right direction. For those that are heading back to the meet and greet, literally just through four sets of double doors, and we'll meet you in the gym. Come on up. You need prayer. Don't be shy. Come on up right now. Whoever you are, you need prayer. If you're sitting with someone that you know needs prayer, walk them up here. We'll get you plugged into the right place. God bless. Have an amazing week.